Hawaii, our 50th state, land of tropical splendor, land of palm trees, land of tiny concrete cubicles. During the peak tourist season, more than 5,000 people come to the islands every day. Tourism is Hawaii's biggest industry, $2.5 billion annually. To keep up with the increasing number of tourists, a lot of hotels have sprung up on Waikiki, with new hotels and buildings being built every day. With so much construction going on, some natives have joked that the state bird should be changed from the nene, the Hawaiian goose, to the crane, the construction crane. I grew up here in Hawaii, in Honolulu, and for me, this place has changed drastically. My mother grew up here, and she remembered when Waikiki was just a worthless piece of swampland. Today, a lot of natives look at Honolulu, at Waikiki, and see just a concrete city. They say Hawaii is being paved over and paradise is getting harder and harder to find. So some Native Hawaiians have given up the urban life to look for their own paradise. They found it in a remote valley on the island of Molokai. To get to this valley, it's a dangerous boat trip or a 14-hour hike through dense jungle. We took a helicopter. For the past year and a half, four families have turned their backs on 20th century Hawaii to live as ancient Hawaiians once did in this beautiful valley. The movement was started by Walter Riddy and a few others, all concerned with the plight of the Hawaiian people, that they were not only losing their identities, but their land as well. At first, the families didn't want to talk with us. Their endeavor is private and personal. But finally, they agreed, because they want others to come to understand why they have chosen this old way of life.
Hawaii is a very small landmass, right? The continent over there is big, it's monstrous. You can do, you have big, big ideas over there. Those kind of values come here, and they can wipe out these islands in no time, cover it with concrete in no time. And we're not just whistling Dixie, it's happening right in Waikiki. If we can't be allowed to do what we're doing, we're gonna come very, very close to having the Hawaiian culture become extinct. Because we're here to experience our Hawaiian culture, because people who lived in this valley were our ancestors, and they did it in a marvelous fashion. And we're trying to learn how they did it so that we don't ruin this valley, because they never ruined the valley. And at the same time, they were very, you know, they survived in a good way. There's no markets, you can't go to the store. So the store is the river, the store is the land, and the store is the ocean.
Is this the way the Hawaiians fished for food at one time?
Yeah, you just go right into the river, like our ancestors did, and you just go and get it. It's there. You know, you bypass the middleman, right? The bamboo provides us with food, and as well as building materials. And right here you can see what we call a bamboo shoot. We'll cut it at the base, and we'll peel off all of the outer covering, and at the very base is a yellow. Good eating, really good eating, good vegetable stuff. And it's delicious. So everything is provided for us inside the valley. It's just a matter of going out and getting what you need.
So the ancient Hawaiians, they lived in separate areas?
Yeah, we found out, you know, what was interesting is when we built our halis, first we built them real big.
Halis meaning?
Hali means the house. And when you put something big up against the elements, you lose. So we realized and we looked back and they told us, no, you have to build them in small little units, one to sleep in, one to eat in. So when you sleep in this one, there's no crumbs coming into your house, there's no mice running around, you know, it's clean and that's the only thing that you use the house for. All the eating is done in the other house. So that's why, if you look right here, then this hali right here was built specifically for cooking, eating, all the food is over here. Mm-hmm. And we come down here, it's a way We got another small unit that can stand the wind, can stand all the elements. And we just, that's where we sleep. And you can build it a little bit different because you don't need that much light because you're only going to use it for sleeping quarters. We're hoping to turn all these hollies into thatched roofs because sooner or later we're not going to be able to get the plastic. It's going to give out. We're going to have to use the elements around here. And the thatching, you know, it's going to give out, but we have it growing all around us. We just put a new one on.
The tree is right here that gave you the roof.
So it's that simple. It's just surviving without having to bring in all the synthetic stuff. And that's what we're working towards. We're going to get there sooner or later.
Loretta Riddy, Miss Hawaii, 1966, now raising her family in this tropical wilderness.
I feel I can survive anywhere and under any conditions, and that's important, being able to survive. And I feel I can do it. I mean, not many people can come in here and do it, you know. I mean, some people can't even light a fire. We've learned how to bake, cook, roast, any kind of thing with a fire, a flame, a little flame that you can adjust yourself, you know. And not many people know how to even start a fire. I never did.
Coming together for a meal is an important part of Hawaii, past and present. The wild goat stew, venison ribs, and homemade bread were delicious. But even in paradise, there are problems. Ever-present pesky mosquitoes. And when it rains, as it did when we were there, mud. Lots of it. And still, the families must rely on helicopters for some supplies and emergency care. But they feel every day they're getting closer to the land and closer to ancient Hawaii.
We're going to have to do a lot of things in order to accomplish what we want to do. It's going to take all of us, everybody doing their thing, everybody teaching their kids, all that kind of stuff. But we're going to get there. I know we're going to get there.